Published under the slogan, All There Is to Know About West Virginia, the West Virginia Encyclopedia is a great companion to West Virginia of film history. This handsome keepsake volume is the perfect gift for West Virginians near and far. Order yours at wvhumanities.org or by calling the West Virginia Humanities Council at 304-346-8500.
Major funding for this program was provided by the State of West Virginia, the Appalachian Regional Commission, the Claude Worthington Benedum Foundation, the Clay Foundation, Salem Tekeel University, the West Virginia Humanities Council, and with the major corporate support of Bank One.
Before I grew up and went out into the world, we were all at home there, in our faded cottage in the meadow. All of us, safe and warm. Then I knew just the earth itself, the quiet measure of the seasons, the primal certainty of spring. Then we were all there together, the years not yet come on us. These years of war and money and torrents of blood. Louise McNeil.
The history of West Virginia is a history of conflict, a history of struggle. But it's also a history of people hanging together, of people struggling, of people surviving, of people knowing who they are, and of people learning how to come together to increasingly address their problems. And we have a sense of community in West Virginia that many other parts of the country wish they had.
It is a place few Americans know, and fewer still understand. A place of terrible beauty that many think of as strange and peculiar. Yet its story is distinctly American. It is the story of a frontier, where native people fought a tide of white settlers until fighting became impossible. And where America's first great military commander nearly resigned in despair after a string of defeats. It is the story of a bitter civil war that pitted neighbor against neighbor in fierce guerrilla warfare. While a deeply religious country boy ravaged his native land with ruthless passion. And a struggle over union led to one state being torn in half. It is the story of an explosion of industry that drew workers from around the world to the mountains of Appalachia, where three young brothers were executed at dusk along a riverbank, igniting America's most famous family feud. Where a feisty 80-year-old labor organizer incited coal miners to armed rebellion. And a skinny, jug-eared police chief shot it out with mine guards in a town called Matewan.
West Virginia is not your average state. In many ways, West Virginia was a guinea pig for the whole country's experiment in industrialization. And there are plenty of communities around the country, around the developed world now, that are waking up and finding that their main local resources are owned by absentee owners, and they're confronting a situation that West Virginia has confronted for over a century.
And it is the story of how an ambitious first lady, shaken by the misery she saw during the Great Depression, created one of America's most controversial social experiments. And a young president focused the nation's attention on a state where the sun does not always shine, he said, but the people do.
My grandfather walked over the mountains as an ex-slave and came into West Virginia and established a home. And I have a very firm love and attachment for the state of West Virginia. I don't believe that my life could be any better anyplace else, and so I intend to try to stay here.
I think the mountains burn themselves into the psyche somehow, or the heart or the soul of people from this place. I first realized it, I think, when I went to study for a semester in England. It's the first time I'd ever been away from West Virginia for more than a week. And at the end of it, I was so homesick. And I could shut my eyes and imagine mountains. And I could almost feel mountains inside of me. It's like this ache. I don't think I've lost that feeling whenever I leave and come back. It's always there. There's a sense that I'm back again, I'm home.
On a clear spring night in 1760, a group of Delaware Indians witnessed a vision. On the face of the moon, they saw a horse gallop violently from the east and overpower a horse in the west. The Indians feared the meaning of what they saw. Within their lifetimes, the vision would become reality. For centuries, Shawnees and other native peoples lived along the western banks of the Ohio River. In spring and summer, the Indians stayed in villages, tending plots of corn, beans, and tobacco. In fall, they left to hunt for elk and buffalo, returning in late winter. Then the cycle began again. We live upon an island, said a Shawnee. In the water is a great turtle holding up the earth, put there by the Great Spirit.
The area south and eastward of the Ohio River was generally considered by the Indians to be a hunting ground, and it was for the use of all the tribes that surrounded it. The southern tribes would come up from the south to hunt there, and even though many of these tribes were bitter enemies and made incursions against each other and fought vicious wars with one another. When they were in this hunting ground, it was a neutral ground. It was where they could commingle, where they could meet, they could talk, and nobody would kill each other.
In 1630, the Iroquois Confederacy, a powerful union of Indian tribes, invaded the Ohio Valley. Outnumbered, the Shawnees were forced to flee. Over time, they returned to their traditional homeland and rebuilt their villages. White traders entered Shawnee villages along the Ohio in the 1720s. From the north came the French, from the east, the English. The traders wanted furs, fox, mink, and especially beaver for hats popular in Europe. In exchange, they offered goods the Indians had never needed: brass kettles, broadcloth shirts, guns, and alcohol.
When these whiskey traders come, they bring 30 or 40 kegs and put them down before us and make us drink and get all the skins that should go to pay for goods. These wicked whiskey sellers, when they have got the Indians in liquor, make them sell the very clothes from their backs.
The Shawnees were soon dependent on European goods. As their need for furs increased, they relied more than ever on their hunting grounds east of the Ohio.
In the morning, we set forward early. When we were got up to the top of the mountain and sat down very weary, we saw high mountains lying to the north and south as far as we could discern. It was a pleasing, though dreadful, sight to see the mountains and hills as if piled one upon another. Robert Fallon.
By 1745, 7,000 Virginians had crossed the Blue Ridge Mountains and settled in the Shenandoah and Potomac Valleys. In the fertile bottomlands, Swiss, German, and Scotch-Irish farmers planted corn and fruit trees. On the grassy uplands, they grazed cattle and horses. A British traveler said the settlers have what many princes would give half their dominions for: health, contentment, and tranquility of mind. Convinced that settlements were essential to controlling land, Virginia promoted Western expansion by offering speculators 1,000 acres for every family they could place west of the Allegheny Mountains. Andrew Lewis, a young surveyor, mapped 50,000 acres in the Greenbrier Valley for a land company owned by his father and other wealthy Virginia planters. Explorer Christopher Gist claimed 200,000 acres for the Ohio Company, which promised to settle 100 families in the Ohio Valley and build a fort for their protection. Virginia's greatest landowner, Lord Fairfax, hired an ambitious 17-year-old to survey his western lands. After 3 years, George Washington knew Western Virginia as well as anyone and was determined to own some of it himself. In response to British settlements, France sent 200 soldiers accompanied by Iroquois scouts and Jesuit priests to claim the Ohio Valley in 1749. The expedition was led by Céloron de Blainville, a vain officer who referred to Indians as "my children." At Shawnee villages along the river, Céloron drove out British traders and left marks of French ownership.
"I had a leaden plate buried on which was engraved the taking possession which I made
in the name of the king, of this river and all those which fall into it. I had also attached to a tree the arms of the king, struck on a plate of iron. The Indians were on the watch to discover me. C'est le Ronde de Blainville.
After Celeron left, Shawnees dug up all the lead plates they could find, tore down the iron plaques, and trampled them underfoot.
The Indian believed that everybody owned the land and nobody owned it. To drive a stake into the earth would be like driving a stake into the breast of their mother. I mean, they considered the earth the mother. When the whites came in and suddenly were building fences, suddenly were claiming lands, cutting down the forest, burning the prairies, destroying, almost always destroying as they came along, this was a concept so far beyond their thinking that it appalled them, and they felt it was very, very wrong.
An Indian who spoke good English came to me and desired to know where the Indians' land lay. For the French claimed all the land on one side of the River Ohio, and the English the other side. My friend, said I, we are all one king's people, and the different color of our skins makes no difference in the king's subjects. Christopher Gist.
In the Greenbrier Valley, 50 Virginia families settled, with more on the way. Rival claims to the Ohio Valley ignited in 1753 when 2,000 French troops began erecting forts along the river. Impressed with the show of force and angered by the advancing Virginia settlements, Shawnees cut off trade with the British and joined the French.
This colony has always been happy and in firm peace with the Indians till lately. The French have, by threats and promises, seduced some of the Indians from the British interest, and with great injustice invaded His Majesty's lands. This is the miserable situation of this colony at present. Robert Dinwiddie.
Virginia Governor Robert Dinwiddie, a former Scottish merchant, sent troops to secure a fort at the forks of the Ohio, the strategic center of the Ohio Valley. One 150 militiamen were led by Major George Washington and Captain Andrew Lewis. En route, Washington learned that French troops had beat him to the forks and built Fort Duquesne there. But he chose to continue on. Near the Monongahela River, Washington defeated a small French patrol, then built a crude defense, Fort Necessity, in preparation for the main attack he knew would come. On July 3rd, a force of several hundred Indians and French troops assaulted the fort. Greatly outnumbered, Washington surrendered. The French let Washington go after he promised to stay away from the Ohio for a year. One of Washington's guides, an Iroquois, said later that the French acted like cowards in the engagement and the English like fools. Dinwiddie appealed to Britain for help. London sent General Edward Braddock, a short, arrogant officer who had spent 45 years in the army, yet had seen almost no fighting. Braddock assembled 1,400 British troops and 400 Virginia militiamen including Lewis and Washington, then marched toward Fort Duquesne. Washington warned of an enemy ambush. Braddock ignored him. Ten miles east of Fort Duquesne, 900 French soldiers and Indian warriors ambushed Braddock's army in a dense forest. Militiamen found cover behind trees. British regulars stood in formation on the narrow road and were cut down from three sides.
Our regulars were immediately struck with such a deadly panic that nothing but confusion and disobedience of orders prevailed amongst them. The Virginians behaved like men and died like soldiers. George Washington.
Nearly 1,000 British troops were killed or wounded. Braddock had 4 horses shot from under him. As he mounted a 5th, a musket ball pierced his lungs. Carried from the battlefield, Braddock looked up and asked, "Who could have thought it?" Washington ordered a retreat. Along the way, Braddock died. Washington buried him in the middle of the road, then marched troops over the grave so Indians wouldn't find it. "We have been beaten," said Washington, "most shamefully beaten by a handful of men." Braddock's defeat left the Virginia frontier completely exposed to French and Indian attacks. Indian war parties now attacked settlements from the Greenbrier River to the Upper Potomac. Frantic settlers abandoned their farms and fled east. Smoke from burning houses filled the valleys. A militia officer warned that soon there wouldn't be a settler west of the mountains. Washington, now commander of the Virginia militia, went to see for himself. In the Potomac Valley, he found the body of a farmer who had been killed by Indians, then partially eaten by wolves.
"I see their situation, know their danger, and participate in their sufferings without having it in my power to give them further relief. Only uncertain promises."
Dispirited, Washington considered resigning his command. On July 8, 1755, Shawnees attacked a small settlement at Draper's Meadows on the New River. They killed 4 settlers and took 5 prisoners, including a pregnant mother, Mary Ingalls, and her 2 sons. Ingalls gave birth to a baby girl as she was led to a Shawnee village west of the Ohio. There, Ingalls' sons were taken from her. Then, a few weeks later, she saw a chance to escape. Knowing she would be caught if she carried a child, Ingalls left her daughter behind and ran. She fled east, struggling through the New River Gorge up into the mountains. She slept in caves, ate roots and berries, and crossed 500 miles of wilderness. 40 days later, Mary Ingalls saw a cabin near a field of corn and shouted for help. In retaliation for Indian raids, Dinwiddie ordered a surprise attack on the Shawnees in the winter of 1756 and put Andrew Lewis in command. A veteran surveyor who had served with Washington, Lewis was strict, dependable, and unemotional. He is reserved and distant, wrote a relative, his presence more awful than engaging. At Fort Frederick on the New River, Lewis assembled 200 militiamen, including Mary Ingalls' husband, William, and 80 Cherokees, traditional enemies of the Shawnees. Captain William Preston's company was typical. Few were native to Virginia. The average age was 24. Only one was 6 feet in height, none taller. Most had no military experience. Lewis planned to march from Fort Frederick to the Big Sandy River, follow it to the Ohio, then assault Shawnee villages. On February 18th, 1756, the expedition set out. Hoping to move quickly and hunt for game along the way, Lewis carried only a 15-day supply of food. Preston's company didn't even bring tents. Almost immediately, heavy rains and the rugged terrain slowed the march. Then, the rain turned to snow as food supplies dwindled.
Wednesday, March 3rd. We marched until sunset and advanced only 9 or 10 miles, being much retarded by the river and mountains which closed in on both sides. Each man had but 1/2 pound of flour and no meat but what we could kill, and that was very scarce. Captain William Preston.
Starving pack horses began to die.
Friday the 5th. We marched about 9 o'clock this morning and with great difficulty proceeded 15 miles on our journey. The river being very deep almost killed the men, and more so as they were in utmost extremity for want of provisions. This day, my 4th horse expired, and I was left on foot with a hungry belly, which increased my woe.
Preston suggested eating the pack horses. His men refused and threatened to desert if food wasn't found soon. Cherokee scouts reported signs of buffalo and turkey ahead, and Lewis ordered the march to continue.
Major Lewis would direct as he thought proper.
for common soldiers were by him scarcely treated with humanity. We were now in a pitiable condition, our men looking on one another with tears in their eyes and lamenting that they had ever entered into a soldier's life. Thomas Morton.
The major stepped off some yards distance and desired all that was willing to serve their country and share his fate to go with him. Not above 20 or 30 joined him. It is impossible to express the abject condition we were in, both before and after the men deserted us. William Preston.
As order disintegrated, Lewis abandoned the expedition. Starving soldiers straggled back to Fort Frederick. William Ingalls returned to Draper's Meadows, where he and Mary had four more children. Thirteen years later, the Ingalls purchased their eldest son, Thomas, from his adopted Shawnee parents. The boy often disappeared for weeks into the wilderness, carrying only his bow and arrow. The Ingalls never saw their other two children again. In 1758, England launched a major campaign against French strongholds in North America. When 6,000 British troops advanced on Fort Duquesne, French soldiers blew up the fort and withdrew. The British built Fort Pitt in its place. British forces captured Montreal, forcing Canada to surrender and France to withdraw from North America. The Treaty of Paris transferred all French territory east of the Mississippi to England. Then, in 1768, England and the Iroquois Confederacy signed the Treaty of Fort Stanwix. For $10,000, the Iroquois dropped their claim to land east of the Ohio River.
The English wanted to believe that the Indians owned land. They needed to have an owner of the land so that they could purchase this land from its rightful owner. The Iroquois never conquered the Shawnee, but they made everybody think they had. When they went to treaties with the whites, The whites said, we want to buy some of your land. And they said, sure, we'll sell you whatever you want. It wasn't their land anyway. This is what caused all the great problems which came later, because then, having made this purchase, the whites claimed it and said, hey, we bought it fair and square, and it's ours. So this is where the wars began.
The white man seeks to conquer nature, to bend it to his will, and use it wastefully until it is all gone, and then he simply moves on. The whole white race is a monster who is always hungry, and what he eats is land. Chicksica.
Virginia rewarded veterans of the French and Indian War with Western land, 5,000 acres for officers, 50 acres for privates. George Washington, one of the few to recognize the land's value, bought the rights to 30,000 acres from his fellow officers.
Any person who neglects the present opportunity of hunting out good lands and marking them for his own in order to keep others from settling them will never regain it.
In the fall of 1770, he set out to claim good farmland along the Ohio. To his surprise, Washington found some of the best land already taken.
People who were skimping out on a little plot of land in the east suddenly saw these great vistas of land open to them if they would just go there and claim it. And so they came in droves. They spilled over the mountains and rushed into these lands and began claiming them as their own. And it was no difficulty. You just simply marked some trees at the four corners of your land, and that was then your land. They were leaving a civilized culture and moving into a wilderness, a hidden land, a land that was really fraught with all kinds of dangers and unexpected happenings. They came in and they built rude cabins with very rude tools. Sometimes the cabins were only 10 feet square or 15 or 20 feet square, just enough to house people and keep them relatively safe and relatively warm. They existed with the very barest of necessities, and it was a very hard and rough and difficult life for them.
The country here is swarming with wolves and wildcats, and those people called squatters who neither pay rent nor own their own land, but keep roving the frontiers, advancing the tide of a civilized population. Alexander Wilson.
Removing these people will be a work of great difficulty, perhaps of equal cruelty, as most of these people are poor, with large families, and have sought out these retreats on which perhaps their future prospects wholly depend. George Washington.
As white settlers pushed westward, a religious movement swept through Indian villages in the Ohio Valley. Indian prophets urged their people to resume a traditional way of life, to observe sacred rituals, and regain the power to take back their land. Militant Shawnees recruited Cherokees, Mingos, and Delawares to join them in a united Indian front and began attacking white surveyors on the Ohio. Bands of whites crossed the river and raided Indian villages.
The Virginians in this part of the country seemed determined to make war with the Indians at any rate. The one half of this country is ruined to all intents and purposes, which only a few months ago was in a flourishing way. Devereaux Smith.
On the night of April 30th, 1774, a group of settlers led by Daniel Greathouse lured eight Indians to the east bank of the Ohio with the promise of free liquor. After drinking together for several hours, the whites suddenly attacked their guests.
The Greathouse party fell on them and terribly massacred them, shot all the men, bludgeoned and stabbed and otherwise desecrated the women, disemboweled them, hung them from trees. One was a pregnant woman. They cut her unborn baby out and even scalped this little baby. So it was just a terrible thing. We hear so much about the atrocities of the Indians, but the atrocities that some of the whites did were just almost beyond belief.
The murders shocked colonial leaders. In the Virginia House of Burgesses, Delegate Thomas Jefferson called the act inhuman and indecent. The royal governor of Virginia, Lord Dunmore, said the event was marked with an extraordinary degree of cruelty. But he did nothing to bring the murderers to justice. Among the victims were the brother and sister of a Mingo leader named Logan. A baptized Christian, Logan was a friend of many whites and an outspoken advocate of peace. One fur trader called Logan the best specimen of humanity I ever met.
I appeal to any white man to say, if ever he entered Logan's cabin hungry and he gave him not meat, if ever he came cold and naked and he clothed him not, in cold blood and unprovoked, men murdered all the relations of Logan, not even sparing my women and children. Who is there to mourn for Logan? Not one.
Logan's grief turned to rage. He led attacks against Western settlements, personally killing 13 whites before returning to his village. I have fully glutted my vengeance, Logan declared. But fighting continued.
The country at this time is in great confusion. There have been broken up and gone off at least 500 families within 1 week. And I believe it has been the white people's fault altogether. Gilbert Simpson.
Lord Dunmore called out the Virginia militia. A cultured Scottish gentleman, known for hosting lavish balls, Dunmore was also a veteran officer who insisted on walking into battle carrying his own equipment. He ordered Major Andrew Lewis to prepare for a combined assault on the Shawnee villages.
The unhappy situation of the people settled over the Allegheny Mountains makes it necessary to give the enemies a blow that will break the Indian Confederacy. Lord Dunmore.
Lewis was to take troops from Camp Union in the Greenbrier Valley west to the Ohio River. Dunmore would lead a force down the Ohio from Fort Pitt and join him. In early September, Lewis and 1,100 Western militiamen set out. This time, Lewis was prepared. He carried 54,000 pounds of flour on 700 pack horses and drove 100 head of cattle. As Lewis advanced, Dunmore and 1,000 troops reached Fort Pitt, where he delayed heading south. Instead, the governor went duck hunting with hounds brought along from Williamsburg. An incredulous frontiersman called Dunmore the most unfit, the most trifling person living. Meanwhile, Shawnee spies learned of the governor's battle plan. The principal Shawnee chief, Cornstalk, decided to attack Lewis before he united with Dunmore. Lewis reached the Ohio in early October and encamped on a narrow tip of land called Point Pleasant.
We looked on ourselves in a safe possession of a fine encampment and thought ourselves a terror to all the Indian tribes on the Ohio. Captain William Ingalls.
On the night of October 9th, 1,000 Indian warriors and 3 whites who had been raised with Shawnees crossed the Ohio a few miles above Point Pleasant. In the darkness, they formed a circle around Lewis's camp.
Just before dawn, the woods began filling up with a fog rising from the Ohio River. Andrew Lewis was preparing to cross the Ohio River that day. and he had given orders that no one was to leave the camp. But two men went out to hunt turkey early in the morning, and they got about a mile away from the main campground, and the fog parted momentarily, and suddenly here they saw before them not turkeys, but a vast line of Indians. One of the men was shot. The survivor ran back and alerted the camp, and the battle began. This was a very terrible battle, very closely fought because of the fog. So it became a hand-to-hand battle from the dawning of day until mid-afternoon.
The enemy disputed the ground with the greatest obstinacy, often running up to the very muzzles of our guns, where they as often fell victim to their rage.
Their bravery exceeded every man's expectations. Their chiefs ran continually along the line, exhorting the men to lie close and shoot well, fight and be strong. William Christian.
Indian war cries mixed with the groans of the wounded. The sound was enough to shudder the stoutest heart, said one officer. Despite heavy casualties, Lewis's men held their ground. That evening, Cornstalk withdrew.
Cornstalk was a very proud man, and he was not going to have it ever be said that he had turned his back on an enemy. And so as he vacated the battlefield, he walked backward all the way, this mile to where his canoe was wedged, got in the canoe and then stood in it, facing backward while it was paddled across the river.
Eager to destroy the Shawnee villages, Lewis took 100 men north to join Dunmore, leaving Colonel William Fleming in charge at Point Pleasant.
My dear Nancy, I take this opportunity to write you that you may be convinced I am yet amongst the living. I received 3 balls, 2 through my left arm and 1 in my left breast. If it please God to spare me, I propose coming home the first opportunity. William Fleming.
The Shawnees returned to their villages, where militant warriors called for another attack. Cornstalk gave them a choice: kill all their women and children and fight to the last man, or negotiate peace. They chose to lay down their arms.
I saw 4 Indian chiefs of the Shawnee Nation who have been at war with the Virginians this summer. It is said they are cruel and barbarous, and I believe they exercise some cruelties. But they are beings endowed with reason and common sense, and are as valuable in the eyes of their Maker as we are, and above our level in many virtues. Nicholas Cresswell.
15 miles outside the Shawnee villages, Cornstalk met Dunmore to sign a peace treaty.
When he arose, he was in no way confused or daunted, but spoke in a distinct and audible voice. His looks, while addressing Lord Dunmore, were truly grand and majestic. I have heard the first orators of Virginia, but never have I heard one whose powers of delivery surpassed those of Cornstalk. Benjamin Wilson.
Lewis arrived to find the treaty already signed. Furious that Dunmore had excluded him, Lewis threatened to attack Indian villages the next day. Dunmore sent him back to Point Pleasant with orders to build a fort. Upon his return to the capital, Williamsburg, Dunmore took credit for pacifying the frontier and was given a hero's welcome. Colonel William Fleming returned home to his wife, Nancy, where after recovering from his wounds, he set up practice as a surgeon. In the spring of 1775, fighting broke out near Boston between British and American troops and quickly erupted into war. Washington, commander of the new Continental Army, requested volunteers from the Virginia frontier. Within a week, two companies left for the battlefront.
Unhappy it is that a brother's sword has been sheathed in a brother's breast. But can a virtuous man hesitate in his choice?
Loyal to the crown, Lord Dunmore seized Virginia's supply of gunpowder and had it put aboard a British ship. When colonial troops captured Williamsburg, Dunmore fled back to England. The Americans were led by General Andrew Lewis. The Revolutionary War forced native people once more to choose sides between warring groups of whites. Many thought an alliance with the British would buy them at least temporary safety. In 1777, known as the Bloody Year of the Three Sevens, Shawnee war parties again struck the Western Virginia frontier, now nearly emptied of young men.
The express came softly to the door. By a gentle tapping, waked the whole family. My father seized his gun. A stepmother dressed the children to be taken to the fort. The greatest care was taken not to waken the youngest child. To the rest, it was enough to say, Indian. Not a whimper was heard afterwards. Joseph Doddridge.
At the Fort Lewis had built near Point Pleasant, Cornstalk warned Commander Matthew Arbuckle that he was no longer able to restrain his young warriors. All Shawnees are our enemies, declared Arbuckle. He took Cornstalk and his son prisoner. A week later, two whites were killed near the fort. An angry mob went to Cornstalk's cell.
Cornstalk arose and met them. Seven or eight bullets were fired into him. I grieved to see him so long a dying, the great Cornstalk, who was undoubtedly a hero. John Stewart.
Five settlers were charged with murder, but they were all acquitted when no witnesses would testify against them.
The Indians, the ones who were old and wise and knew the way things were going, said that there was no way to defeat the whites because the whites were like the leaves on the trees, numberless. They were like the grass beneath their feet that even when cut down would spring back up with more and more than there were before. They were like the worm which when cut in half would make not one dead worm but two new worms. When an Indian died, it was a great tragedy, a great loss to the people that caused a sorrow in their heart. An Indian was irreplaceable to them.
After 5 years of warfare, 200 Indians and British soldiers surrounded Fort Henry on Wheeling Creek in September 1782. Leading the attack was Joseph Brant, an educated Mohawk chief who was also an officer in the British Army. When ammunition in the fort ran low, 16-year-old Betty Zane volunteered to get gunpowder stored in a nearby house.
She said, "Your lives are more important than mine, and maybe they won't shoot because I'm a woman." So she gathered up her skirts and took a running start and hit the ground going as fast as she could, and the Indians yelled out, "A squaw, a squaw," and didn't shoot. They poured a keg of gunpowder into her apron, and then she ran back. And by this time, the Indians were waiting, and they started firing at her. And spurts of ground flew up all around her as she ran, but she managed to get back with the gunpowder and save the day.
Brant withdrew the next day. Raids continued, but Fort Henry was the last large-scale Indian battle in Western Virginia. The following year, England and the United States signed the Peace of Paris, ending the war. England gave up its land south of Canada and east of the Mississippi. The treaty didn't mention any land for Indians. With peace, settlers poured across the mountains.
My dear sister, this country has suffered much by the Indians this summer. If we had trade and peace with the Indians, we might live very well. But at present, my advice is never to think of coming through the wilderness to this country. I remain your ever affectionate, Anne Christian.
In 1794, President Washington sent 3,000 troops under Anthony Wayne to secure the western frontier. At the Battle of Fallen Timbers near Lake Erie, Wayne defeated a force of 2,000 Indians, then burned their villages to the ground. The defeat crushed Indian hopes of keeping their lands in the Ohio Valley. Embittered and demoralized, the Shawnees moved west.
It was fate. The time had come for the Indian epic to end east of the Mississippi.
In 1805, a Gilmer County man saw an Indian behind a tree near his house. He shot and killed him without asking questions.
These counties, remote from commerce and civilized life, confined to their everlasting hills of freezing cold, present a distinct republic of their own, every way different from any people. Anne Royal.
Most of the people who settled the mountains came out of choice, not out of chance. They were looking for a terrain that was similar to the areas that they had known in the old country, to land that was rich and valleys that were rich. It was a group of people who came seeking independence and a sense of community and a lifestyle and a way of looking at life that really set them apart, I think, from what one might have found in the New England colonies or in the Deep South or on the far western frontier.
Oh, how many thousands of poor souls have we to seek out in the wilds of America, who are but one remove from the Indians and the comforts of civilized society. And considering that they have the Bible in their hands, worse in their morals than the savages. Francis Asbury.
He was an itinerant minister who rode thousands of miles every year through a frontier nearly empty of churches. Francis Asbury, America's first Methodist bishop, preached in open fields and hog barns 6 days a week, three times on Sundays. Everywhere, he delivered a simple and appealing message. All believers were saved, not just a chosen few.
At Cheat River, we had a mixed congregation of sinners, Presbyterians, Baptists, and it may be, of saints.
Asbury performed baptisms, marriages, funerals, and trained other backwoods ministers to spread the word. Known as circuit riders, they were so zealous that a common saying in bad weather went, "There is no one out today but crows and Methodist preachers."
My mind has been severely tried under the great fatigue endured by myself and my horse. This country will require much to make it tolerable. The people are the boldest caste of adventurers. Francis Asbury.
In the mountains, circuit riders found a people often more concerned with survival than salvation. Eastern clergymen claimed that mountain people were godless, yet many welcomed a faith that accepted them as they were.
Frequently, aspects of frontier life involved drinking and activities that would be deemed to be unacceptable back east. That doesn't mean that mountain people were not religious. That sense of distinction between a personal religion, which is the kind of religion I think that one finds in the mountains, and abiding by the tenets and rules of some larger national denomination or larger national expectations, has been one of those things that has set the mountains off from other areas of the country, and I think is directly associated with the strong sense of independence that one finds in the region.
Methodist prayer services grew into camp meetings lasting several days. Thousands came to pray and sing from dawn till midnight. They pitched tents and filled tables with hams, biscuits, and apple pies. Organizers posted guards in a losing effort to keep out whiskey.
A well-regulated camp meeting is one of the best institutions in the world to quicken and stir up believers and to get souls converted to God. Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! I could live and die at such a place in such exercise. Daniel Hitt.
By 1810, the population of Western Virginia approached 100,000. Increasingly, Methodist churches dotted a landscape of towns and villages. Yet much of the land remained wild and remote, its people fiercely independent. In 1818, the National Road, America's first federal highway, was completed from Cumberland, Maryland to Wheeling, Virginia. Mail coaches, Conestoga wagons, and herds of cattle filled the road, which connected the eastern seaboard with the Ohio River, the gateway to the west. Steamboats, a recent invention, carried freight and passengers from Wheeling to New Orleans. In Wheeling, a village of less than 1,000, the national road's impact was enormous. Iron foundries, cotton mills, distilleries, glass and tobacco factories opened along the waterfront. The road brought thousands of European immigrants who found work as laborers. By 1825, Wheeling had grown into an industrial center with the second largest population in Virginia. Only Richmond, the capital, was bigger. Despite its growth, Western Virginia had little political power within the state. Eastern counties held more seats in the legislature, and Virginia law limited voting rights to landowners, which favored wealthy Eastern planters and excluded many Western laborers. Western delegate John George Jackson called the situation a burlesque upon representative government. In response to complaints from Western leaders, Virginia called a convention in 1829 to review its constitution. Representing Brooke County in northwestern Virginia was Alexander Campbell, an energetic Irish preacher who had formed his own dissident church, the Disciples of Christ. Campbell argued against basing suffrage on wealth. Why not use strength, intellect, or artistic talent as a standard, he asked.
It is not the increase of population in the West which you ought to fear. It is the energy which the mountain breeze and Western habits impart to these immigrants. The Old Dominion has long been celebrated for producing men that can split hairs in all questions of political economy. But when they return from Congress, they have Negroes to fan them asleep. A Western Virginia statesman, though far inferior in rhetoric, has this advantage, that when he returns home, he takes off his coat and takes hold of the plow. This preserves his Republican principles, pure and uncontaminated. Alexander Campbell.
Campbell proposed giving the vote to all white males, but Eastern delegates rejected the idea.
What real share does any man suppose the peasantry of the West can or will take in affairs of state? Benjamin Lee.
Western leaders returned home empty-handed. The Wheeling Gazette called for dividing Virginia. Peaceably if we can, it wrote. Forcibly if we must. In the summer of 1831, Nat Turner, an educated slave who had visions of black and white spirits engaged in battle, led slaves on a rampage through Southampton County, Virginia. Fifty-five whites were killed. Turner and 16 other slaves were captured and hanged at Jerusalem, the county seat. Turner's rebellion spread panic throughout the South. Virginia increased its militia, restricted the movement of slaves, and prohibited their education. But some Virginians began to question slavery itself.
Before I leave this government, I will have contrived to have a law passed gradually abolishing slavery in this state, or to begin the work by prohibiting slavery on the west side of the Blue Ridge Mountains. Governor John Floyd.
Nobody knows the trouble I see. Nobody knows my sorrow. Nobody knows the trouble I see. Glory, hallelujah. Sometimes I'm up, sometimes I'm down.
Oh, slavery existed in most Western counties, but on a smaller scale than that found on Eastern Virginia plantations. Farmers usually owned only a few slaves and often worked beside them in the fields. Yet conditions for slaves in Western Virginia could be as bad as anywhere. Slave families were routinely separated. A slaveholder in Shepherdstown offered to sell a female slave with or without her four children. In Harper's Ferry, a woman gave her granddaughter a slave as a birthday present. In the hot salt works along the Kanawha River, slaves were leased, not bought, because the dangerous work wore them out so quickly. Runaway slaves were lashed publicly over several days, each new whipping called tickling up the old scabs. Those who weren't caught headed for the Ohio River.
The Ohio River was the gateway to freedom. If you could get to the Ohio River and get across, you were in free territory. All along on the Ohio side of the river, colonies began to develop with free black people in them. There was land ownership, they were raising crops, they were involved in shipping and steamboating and barrel making, and they were beginning to be educated. There were small schools that were developing just across the river. So those communities which were developing presented a view of what life as free people could be for those slaves who were still on the Virginia side.
In Parkersburg on the Ohio, Robert Simmons, the son of a slave and her white master, opened a barber shop, wrote newspaper articles under an assumed name, and organized the first free school for blacks in the South. Many Western Virginians who didn't own slaves resented those who did. If you desire to employ slave labor, a farmer told a new resident, I would advise you to go to hell, as slavery is said to flourish best in warm climates. Here, you will find yourself among a people who can take care of themselves. Yet few Westerners objected to slavery on moral grounds.
We desire to be impartial on this subject, being neither in love with slavery nor abolitionism. As a philosopher and a Christian, I would say to the North, Let the South have their slaves. And throw no impediment in the way. Alexander Campbell.
Campbell suggested sending all blacks, slave and free, back to Africa. In 20 years, he said, slavery in America would disappear.
When we arrived at the springs, all the walks leading from the different cabins were streaming lively forms. A band was playing gaily in the dining hall, and the whole face of things had the look of enchantment, as if the inhabitants of some fairy isle were turning out to welcome the coming of expected strangers.
At first, they came for the water. Believers claimed it relieved headaches, arthritis, even mental disorders. It cures ugliness itself, said one, causes sailors to forget and lawyers to confess the truth. Spurred by epidemics of cholera and yellow fever in the lowlands, the elite of Eastern Virginia escaped in summertime to Western Virginia's mountain spas.
All of the first old Virginia and Carolina families were at the springs when I arrived. I was never at any watering place in England where the company was so good and so select. Frederick Marriott.
The most famous resort was White Sulphur Springs in the Greenbrier Valley. Elegant cottages fanned out in rows, including Paradise Row for newlyweds and Wolf Row for bachelors.
White Sulphur has something eminently aristocratic about it. You feel that you are with your fellows here. John H.B. Latrobe.
Opposite the cottages sat the massive Grand Central Hotel, 400 feet long, known to patrons as simply the White. If I can't go to the White as I am accustomed to, declared a Richmond judge, I'll just stay home and die. It was the closest thing the Old South had to a summer capital.
The power in the Congress was in Southern hands, in Southern congressmen. And the president were coming to talk to the congressmen and meet them on their own turf. So Andrew Jackson, Tyler, Van Buren, Fillmore, Pierce, Buchanan, these are all pre-war presidents who came here. And you could meet who you needed to meet. It's sort of a concentration of power and money, but in a resort atmosphere.
The hotel dining room seated 1,200 guests. Many brought their own slaves to serve them. Others relied on slaves owned by the hotel.
If you have no servant, you must bribe one of those attached to the place, or you run the risk of getting little or nothing. Bribe high, and you live high. Avoid bribery, and you starve. John H.B. Latrobe.
By the late 1850s, White Sulphur Springs had replaced nearly 100 of its slaves with free blacks. The change went largely unnoticed by the resort's slave-holding patrons, but its larger meaning would soon become painfully clear. On the morning of June 1st, 1858, 50 prominent American artists boarded a train at the Camden Street Depot in Baltimore. They were guests of the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad, the proud owner of what few had thought possible, a rail line over the Allegheny Mountains.
The B&O was, in many regards, a high-stakes gamble. I would equate it to deciding in the late 1950s to go to the moon. The people here didn't have the technology, didn't have the engineering, didn't have the knowledge to really know they could get across those mountains. Deciding to do that was an act of faith and courage as much as a hard-headed business decision.
Now the B&O wanted to call attention to its achievement by sending artists on an excursion. One car had been converted into a darkroom. Easels and writing tables filled two cars. The dining car was outfitted with a piano, sofas, and cases of champagne. Officials encouraged the artists to stop the train any time so they could paint or photograph whatever impressed them.
This is the first time in this country anything like this had ever been done. And the railroads were looking around for ways to increase their visibility to get business. We didn't have advertising agencies then. We didn't have any of these modern notions of shaping public opinion. The railroad, I suppose, was trying to exploit these artists. The artists apparently didn't feel exploited at all. They thought they were taking advantage of the railroad.
It cannot be that the brightest, busiest, and freest people on earth who have built this vast temple to civilization in the Western wilderness will ever rest until the work is crowned by the ennobling hand of art.
David Hunter Strother.
Among the artists was David Hunter Strother of Martinsburg, Virginia. Strother had studied art in New York and Europe, painted portraits to support himself, then returned home broke and despondent. He abandoned painting and began writing and illustrating travel stories for Harper's Magazine under the pen name Port Crayon. The stories were immensely popular, and Strother soon became one of the highest paid writers in America.
As the train commenced ascending the mountain, a number of the excursionists took their seats on the front of the cowcatcher for the purpose of obtaining a better view of the grand scenes which were opening before them. The groups of lofty firs near at hand, the silvery streamlets flashing through somber thickets of evergreen, the gorgeous bouquets of azalea and mountain honeysuckle that recalled the luxuriance of the tropics.
This was a safari to them. They were bringing back images and impressions of a land that was only vaguely known to the 90% of the population that lived within 20 miles of the East Coast. What they came back with were a series of photographs and sketches, paintings, drawings that showed the wilderness being opened by the railroad. We were making this place useful to human beings, and these artists recognized that. That's how they represented this, that the railroad was good, or at least the railroad was neutral, and it was allowing people to go west in a way that they hadn't been able to before.
...380 miles from Baltimore, the train pulled to a stop at Wheeling, where the artists were greeted with cannon fire and taken on a tour of the town.
Wheeling is like many a child we've seen that would be very pretty if its face was washed. David Hunter Strother.
It was a town that had a dichotomy of society. There was a very high society who lived in grand homes. Some had slaves as house servants. And so people were living very well, going to theater, going to concerts, going to scholarly lectures. They were enjoying the finer things of life. But that was only a select group in the community. And then there was the other side of the coin, the laborers and the wagoners who drank a lot, who fought a lot, the people who did not have much money and worked so hard, were ill, led what we would consider miserable lives.
The idiosyncrasy of this town is smoke. It rolls sullenly from the great chimneys of the iron foundries and settles down in black, slimy pools on the muddy streets. Smoke on the wharfs, smoke on the dingy boats, on the yellow river. Clinging in a coat of greasy soot to the house front, the faded poplars, the faces of the passers-by. Rebecca Harding.
She was curious, sensitive, and remarkably observant. Raised in an upper-class home, Rebecca Harding became fascinated with the working-class life outside her window. In her early 20s, she began to write about it.
A cloudy day. Do you know what that is in a town of ironworks? The air is thick, clammy with the breath of crowded human beings. It stifles me. I open the window and can scarcely see through the rain the grocer's shop opposite, where a crowd of drunken Irishmen are puffing Lynchburg tobacco in their pipes. I can detect the scent through all the foul smells ranging loose in the air.
In her steel-ribbed corsets and dragging skirts, Harding explored Wheeling's gritty industrial district where thousands of Irish, Welsh, and German laborers toiled.
Masses of men with dull faces bent to the ground. Skin and muscle and flesh begrimed with smoke and ashes, stooping all night over boiling cauldrons of metal, breathing from infancy to death an air saturated with fog and grease and soot, vileness for soul and body.
Harding's story, Life in the Iron Mills, published in the Atlantic Monthly, shocked readers across the country. It was the first time that an American writer had portrayed industrialism in such realistic terms. Southerners claimed it showed that working conditions in northern factories were worse than those on plantations. As the slavery conflict intensified, Western Virginia, with its slave and free labor, became a border between two ways of life. On a warm spring day in 1859, Rebecca Harding saw a gaunt man walking down a street in Wheeling. His eyes fixed and lips moving, she noted, like a man under the influence of morphia. He was a poor farmer from the West, Harding wrote in her diary, who was insane on the question of slavery. A few days later, the man left town, heading east. On the night of October 16, 1859, John Brown and 18 followers crossed the Potomac River into Harper's Ferry, Virginia. There, they easily seized the federal armory and arsenal, took a half dozen prisoners, then barricaded themselves in the arsenal engine house. Little else in Brown's life had gone as smoothly. He had roamed through 6 states, failed as a cattleman, merchant, and land speculator, fathered 20 children, and fallen deeply into debt. Yet Brown felt God had given him a special mission.
John Brown came to Harper's Ferry because of the United States Armory and Arsenal. There were 100,000 weapons stored in 2 arsenal buildings here at Harper's Ferry. Brown intended to utilize those weapons to bring about an end of slavery throughout the South, and Harper's Ferry would be the beginning of that liberation. Brown had convinced himself that he was an instrument of God, that he had been sent here by Jehovah with the Bible as his creed to declare war against slavery.
Just after midnight, Brown's men killed Hayward Shepherd, a free black who worked for the railroad. At dawn, they seized 2 dozen armory workers as they reported for work. But then, Brown let a train from Wheeling pass through town, and its conductor quickly spread the alarm. Units of the Virginia militia arrived that afternoon and killed Dangerfield Newby, an ex-slave. Newby had joined Brown with the hope of freeing his wife and children who were still in bondage. Someone cut off his ears as souvenirs. 3 more of Brown's men were killed in sporadic fighting. Townspeople shot at 2 of the lifeless bodies throughout the day. The 3rd was partially eaten by a hog. That night, 90 United States Marines arrived from Washington. They were led by Robert E. Lee, a 52-year-old Army colonel. At dawn the next day, Lee demanded that Brown surrender. When he refused, Marines battered a hole in the engine house door.
And the first man through was a Marine, Lieutenant Israel Green. He struck Brown and pushed him down, but the sword did not penetrate. Brown was wearing a buckle, and the sword had struck that buckle with such force that instead of penetrating, it almost broken it in half. And this is where history becomes a matter of a quarter of an inch. A quarter of an inch high or low, or a quarter of an inch to the right or to the left, away from that buckle, that sword would have penetrated Brown, and he would have died on that very cold brick floor.
Lieutenant Green clubbed Brown unconscious, and his small army surrendered. As Brown was carried out of the engine house, a hushed silence fell on the crowd that had gathered.
No one can feel any sympathy for Brown after they see the dreadful instruments he had prepared to kill us with. I had one of the spikes in my hand and examined it. They are made rough and coarse. They were for the Negroes to use. Oh, he is a dreadful man. May the Lord have mercy on him, for man cannot. Molly Hansford.
The death toll of the raid was 16. Including 1 Marine and 2 of Brown's sons. In the Jefferson County Courthouse in Charlestown, Brown and his 4 surviving followers were put on trial for murder, treason against Virginia, and inciting slaves to riot. Special Prosecutor Andrew Hunter vowed to have Brown tried, sentenced, and hung, all within 10 days. 3 days later, Brown was found guilty on all counts and sentenced to death. The judge asked if he had any final words.
Had I so interfered in behalf of any of the rich, the powerful, or in behalf of any of their friends, it would have been all right. And every man in this court would have deemed it an act of reward rather than punishment. I believe that to have interfered as I have done in behalf of his despised poor is no wrong, but right. John Brown.
Virginia Governor Henry Wise received hundreds of letters requesting clemency for Brown. Fearing a revolt, Wise declared martial law in Charlestown and ordered strangers arrested on sight. Brown's wife Mary arrived from Kansas. In his jail cell, they talked for several hours. Then Mary left to await delivery of her husband's body. On December 2nd, reporters from across the country, including David Hunter Strother, joined 1,500 soldiers around a gallows outside Charlestown. Cadets from the Virginia Military Institute were issued new muskets from the Harper's Ferry arsenal and told to prepare for any emergency. Their commander was Major Thomas J. Jackson, a pious, eccentric West Point graduate from Western Virginia.
I was much impressed with the thought that before me stood a man in the full vigor of health who must in a few moments enter eternity. I sent up the petition that he might be saved. I hope that he was prepared to die, but I am doubtful. Thomas Jackson.
At 11:30 a.m., a sheriff cut the trapdoor rope with a hatchet, and John Brown fell to his death.
John Brown carved a canyon, a grand canyon, between the North and the South. No longer could you stand on top of the fence and not topple, either for slavery or against slavery. Brown took away the opportunity for compromise.
This will be the date of a new revolution, wrote Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. Quite as much needed as the old one. In November of 1860, an Illinois congressman was elected the 16th president of the United States. A moderate on slavery, Abraham Lincoln's election sent shockwaves through the South. South Carolina seceded from the Union, followed soon by six other states. Virginia hesitated.
I am strong for the Union at present, and if things become no worse, I hope to continue so. Thomas Jackson.
In any aspect we view the existing state of things in Virginia, nothing but confusion, conflict, and strife is foreboded. Archibald Campbell.
Newspaper editor Archibald Campbell, the nephew of Alexander Campbell, had fallen in with abolitionists while at college in New York. Now he began using his paper, the Wheeling Intelligencer, to rally public support for the creation of a new state, free of slavery, in Western Virginia.
There is now on foot a grand counter-movement, having for its object a division of the state at the Blue Ridge. This popular movement awaits only the opportunity and pretext for assuming formidable proportions.
Then, on April 12, 1861, Confederate guns fired on Fort Sumter. The news ignited demonstrations in Richmond. An exuberant crowd tore down the Stars and Stripes from atop the Capitol. Inside, a special convention debated Virginia's secession. Western delegate John S. Carlisle, a failed businessman who had become an eloquent political showman, led the fight against secession. "Carlisle is an enemy," wrote the Richmond Inquirer, "against whom we warn the true men of Virginia."
Dissolve the Union and hitch Virginia to the tail of a Southern Confederacy to stand guard for King Cotton? I drop the pen. I cannot contemplate the picture. I turn with horror from such a sight. John Carlisle.
Waitman T. Willie, a self-taught lawyer from Monongalia County who had set his slaves free, warned that Virginia would break apart if it left the Union.
The idea of a division of the state is new to the people. But I've never known so rapid a progress of opinion in favor of any measure as there seems to be in favor of this. Waitman Willie.
A Western farmer put it more directly. "We will not fight for the nigger traders," he warned. "Happen what will." On April 15th, Lincoln issued a call for troops. 2 days later, former Governor Henry Wise entered the Virginia Convention, drew a pistol from his shirt, and announced that the state militia had seized the federal arsenal at Harper's Ferry.
Order! Gentlemen, order!
That evening, the convention passed an ordinance of secession, removing Virginia from the Union. Militia forces at Harper's Ferry were put under the command of Colonel Thomas Jackson, who had not hesitated in siding with his native Virginia. Orphaned at a young age, Jackson was raised on his uncle's farm at Jackson's Mill on the West Fork River. He had poor eyesight, was partially deaf, and suffered from numerous ailments, which he said were punishments from God for his sins. Obsessed with his health, Jackson refused to drink tea or coffee, ate fruit only in the morning, and often held up an arm so blood could flow back into his body.
"People who are anxious to bring on war don't know what they are bargaining for. They don't see all the horrors that must accompany such an event." Thomas Jackson.
In May, Confederates led by Colonel George A. Porterfield occupied Grafton, a strategic junction of the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad, 80 miles southeast of Wheeling. In response, Union General George B. McClellan, a skilled engineer who had worked briefly for the B&O Railroad, sent federal troops across the Ohio River.
"To the Union men of Western Virginia, now that we are in your midst, I call upon you to fly to arms and sever the connection that binds you to traitors. Proclaim to the world that faith and loyalty, so long boasted by the Old Dominion, is still preserved in Western Virginia. George McClellan."
McClellan ordered General Benjamin Kelly, who had been selling hardware only a month earlier, to retake Grafton. Outnumbered, Porterfield withdrew south to Philippi and encamped beside the Buchanan River. Kelly advanced. And at dawn on June 3rd, Union cannon opened fire.
We were startled by a loud explosion with the cry, "The enemy! The enemy!" The balls were falling and hissing all around us. All was now confusion. The infantry was rushing toward Dixie's Land in great disorder. Private John Lyon Hill.
The first land battle of the Civil War was over in a few minutes. No one was killed, but Kelly was seriously wounded in the chest. Federal troops pursued the fleeing Confederates in what became known as the Philippi Races. In June, Union forces advanced toward Jackson's troops at Harper's Ferry. Jackson, now sporting a full beard, dismantled the Federal armory, sent its machinery to Richmond, and set the building on fire. Then he withdrew. On his way out of town, Jackson blew up the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad Bridge.
Jackson certainly was not comfortable with destroying property in Virginia, but Jackson was a warrior. Those were simply the results of war, a war he did not want, a war that many other Virginians did not desire. But now that he had thrown his hat in with the Confederacy, he would execute the edicts of war, and if that war brought death, misery, and destruction, so be it.
Only one armory building escaped destruction, the engine house, now called John Brown's Fort.
The appearance of ruin by war and fire was awful. Charred ruins were all that remained of the splendid public works. Arsenals, stores, hotels, and houses all mingled in one common destruction.
David Hunter Strother.
Recently married, David Hunter Strother had returned with his bride to his father's hotel at Berkeley Springs, planning to sit out the war. Now, with fighting so near, Strother realized that was impossible and promptly enlisted in the Union Army.
Volunteering in Monongalia moves very tardily. Each man thinks he is not the one to do the fighting, but would rather do the talking. The men of means stood off, as if they had no lot or part in this matter, but seemed to think the poor man ought to do the fighting. James Evans.
The great majority of people did not want to take an absolute position. They wanted the problem to go away. But as often happens in periods that we look back and call great moments in history, in fact, public affairs intruded into private lives, and they required people to make a choice. They made it quickly, they made it slowly, they stuck with it, they backed out of it. But everybody had to make private decisions in response to this crisis in public affairs.
Nineteen-year-old Joshua Winters left his family's farm near the Ohio River for a Union camp 200 miles to the east. It was the farthest he had ever been from home.
There are 16 of us in one tent. We have a stove in the middle, and we get along first rate at night. When we all get it cutting up, we have a great time. There's an awful sight of men here now, and more are coming. Joshua Winters.
In Wheeling, three brothers enlisted. One with the Union, and two with the Confederacy.
I have been putting the last finishing touches to poor Sill's clothes, marking his shirts and stockings. My dear, dear husband, I clung to him with tears and sobs which I could not repress. The last lingering kiss and embrace was given, and he went from my sight, and perhaps forever. Marcia Phillips.
20-year-old James Hall of Philippi left college and joined the Barbara Grays.
I have volunteered in the Confederate Army. I cannot fully visualize the stern realities of war. Scenes of carnage and death await. Be it so. We will consider our lives a small offering for our native land. May God avert the danger which now threatens her. James Hall.
As the war intensified, pro-Union leaders meeting in the Custom House at Wheeling declared the Richmond government null and void. They formed the reorganized government of Virginia, with Wheeling as its capital, and named a new Virginia governor loyal to the Union. Francis Harrison Pierpont, a former schoolteacher and lawyer for the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad, vowed to raise more Union troops, despite the fact that his government had no money.
The putting down of the rebellion is of vastly more importance to us and to the world than the formation of a new state. Francis Pierpont.
He secured bank loans, personally guaranteeing the notes, and seized $27,000 intended for a new state insane asylum. Within a month, Pierpont had recruited and equipped 20,000 Union volunteers.
Frank Pierpont is one of those men well fitted for the stormy and revolutionary times that are upon us. A truer man to the cause of the Union does not live. Archibald Campbell.
Determined to maintain the standards of the governor's office, Pierpont bought himself a tailored suit to replace what he called his homespun clothes. But he refused to employ a black servant and had the uniform bought for one returned.
We enjoy this life very much. So healthy and so pretty a country is rarely seen. This is the land of blackberries. We are a great grown-up armed blackberry party, and we gather untold quantities. Rutherford B. Hayes.
A Harvard Law School graduate, Rutherford B. Hayes arrived in Western Virginia with the 23rd Ohio in the summer of 1861.
The people here are divided. Many of the leading ladies are secessionists. We meet many good Union men. The other men are prudently quiet.
Hey,
In July, Union soldiers won a decisive victory at Rich Mountain in the Tigard Valley. At Gauley River in September, Federal troops defeated rebels under former Virginia Governor John B. Floyd. By the fall, Union forces controlled all of northwestern Virginia and most of the Kanawha Valley and the B&O Railroad. Rebels still held the Greenbrier and other southeastern valleys. In the Greenbrier Valley, Confederate General Henry Wise set up his headquarters at White Sulphur Springs. Rebel soldiers signed the hotel's register alongside wealthy Southern guests who hadn't let a war stop their annual vacation. Yet for most Confederates encamped in the mountains, conditions couldn't have been worse. Food and supplies were scarce. It rained constantly, then snowed. Diseases spread. Pneumonia, mumps, then an epidemic of measles.
I entered the house, a deserted dwelling, which was filled with the sick. I saw many there who appeared so intellectual and highly educated, who undoubtedly were bright ornaments to society, leaving the world in such a place. I involuntarily breathed a prayer to their Creator, who knows all. James Hall.
Secure behind Union lines, Pierpont's government chose John S. Carlisle and Waitman T. Willie as United States senators from loyal Virginia. Carlisle immediately called for the formation of a new state.
Borne down by an Eastern governmental majority, we have endured the disastrous results that ever must flow from an unnatural connection. Cut the knot now. Cut it now. Apply the knife. John Carlisle.
They view this as an opportunity. Here's our chance to assert our individuality, our independence, a new state. We West Virginians, this is our time has come. All these pent-up emotions and feelings and frustrations that had been building for 30, 40 years. Now we can do something. Our day has come.
Supporters haggled over the state's name, suggesting New Virginia, Allegheny, then Kanawha.
The name Kanawha is a very hard name to spell. I think the rose would smell sweeter by some other name. Waitman Willie.
Finally, they compromised on West Virginia. The proposed new state contained 50 counties, including several in the Northeast, where the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad operated.
The inclusion of this territory is essential to the welfare of this new state. The Baltimore and Ohio Railroad is the great artery that feeds our country. We cannot do without it.
Berkeley, Morgan, Hampshire counties, Jefferson County, those were tied very much to the old Virginia plantation economy. If they didn't go with the new state of West Virginia, part of the B&O would continue to operate through a Confederate state, through hostile territory. the United States government, the new government of West Virginia, the management of the B&O, pretty much everybody decided that it was in the best interests of everybody if the B&O lay entirely within this new state of West Virginia.
Thomas Jackson, now called Stonewall after the Battle of Manassas, occupied Berkeley Springs in January of 1862. There, his men ransacked the Strother Hotel. David Hunter Strother's father, distraught at the damage, died 2 weeks later. In the spring, Jackson led his troops on a brilliant campaign in the Shenandoah Valley, repeatedly defeating larger Union forces before disappearing into the hills. Jackson, who prayed 3 times a day, seemed fearless under fire. "My religious beliefs teach me to feel as safe in battle as in bed," he told a fellow officer. "God has fixed the time for my death." His fame spread, first throughout the South, then everywhere. On May 29, 1862, Waitman T. Willie presented West Virginia's application for statehood to the United States Senate.
"The division of the state of Virginia is a physical, a political, and commercial necessity. It is indispensable to the development of the great natural resources of West Virginia and to the prosperity and happiness of its inhabitants."
Senator Charles Sumner of Massachusetts, a leading abolitionist, demanded that West Virginia only be admitted as a free state. Senator Carlisle insisted that residents of the state be given the choice over slavery.
"Congress will hesitate long before it consents to the subdivision of a slave state, simply that 2 slave states may be made out of it." Archibald Campbell.
Willie proposed an amendment providing for the gradual elimination of slavery in the new state. The Senate passed the statehood bill with Willie's amendment attached. Carlisle voted against it. Carlisle's supporters were shocked. "His conversion is greater than that of St. Paul," said a colleague.
"Carlisle has run himself clear underwater. The people would have forgiven him almost anything except his vote against the new state." Chester Hubbard.
"The most lively topic here," wrote a Wheeling woman, "is the detestation of Carlisle."
John Carlisle probably never understood why he was rejected, why he became an object of complete scorn. He didn't like the Willie Amendment, which stated that West Virginia would have to become a free state before it could enter the Union. It wasn't, you see, that Carlisle objected to the new state. He didn't want a new state on the terms on which it was being offered. He could not adjust to change. And being unable to adjust to change, he willingly consigned himself to oblivion.
The statehood bill passed in the House of Representatives in December and was sent to President Lincoln for his signature. Lincoln worried that the bill violated a provision in the Constitution that said no state could be divided against its will. In giving its consent, Lincoln wondered, had the Wheeling government spoken for Virginia?
"Mr. President, as your friend, as an original, unconditional, and unchangeable Union man, I say that you can never afford to veto this new state bill. A veto would be the death warrant of unionism in Western Virginia. Very sincerely and respectfully, Archibald Campbell.
Pierpont threatened to resign if Lincoln vetoed the bill. Finally, on December 31st, Lincoln signed it. The division of a state is dreaded as a precedent, he said, but a measure made expedient by a war is no precedent for times of peace.
Lincoln couldn't have done anything else but sign the statehood bill. And one of the things he talks about is that we need every West Virginian, every mother's son, to fight in the Union Army, to volunteer. We need West Virginia regiments already in the field to re-volunteer. I mean, he's very conscious that if he hadn't signed the bill, this would have been so disappointing that he would have lost the support, perhaps, of the populace.
West Virginia became the 35th state in the Union, and the only one torn from the body of another.
Hard it is at this old camp chase, nothing to eat, nothing to drink, nothing to do but dig out in the cold ground, and it's hard times. We could cut a pine plank in two in a minute and make our escape just as we begin it. But we're waiting for old Abe and old Jeff to arrange so that our prisoners can be exchanged, and it's hard times. Then we'll go back to old Stonewall Jack. We'll get a permit and we'll go and bushwhack, and it's hard times. We'll kill all those Yanks and take all their goods. Then we'll skedaddle back into the woods, and it's hard times.
In 1863, as Union and Confederate armies in Western Virginia were locked in a military stalemate, a second war emerged. A war without uniforms or codes of conduct. Farmers, boys, and deserters formed irregular Confederate units with colorful names. The Moccasins, the Black Striped Company, McNeil's Rangers. In Logan County, Anderson Hatfield and two of his brothers formed the Logan Wildcats. The Hatfields picked off dozens of Union soldiers, including one of their neighbors, Private Harmon McCoy.
The country outside our lines is full of guerrillas and horse thieves. The staid people wish them to the devil, although their own friends and relatives are among the plunderers.
David Hunter Strother.
Called bushwhackers by their Union enemies, the guerrillas harassed Federal troops and terrorized Union supporters. Bushwhackers beheaded one Federal courier. Another was found tied to a tree, his naked body riddled with bullets.
The guerrilla warfare simply shows the inability of the Union Army really to govern or to control Western Virginia. Northwestern Virginia, where the population was already committed to Union, there was no problem. But the rest of the state could not be governed. Union troops controlled the cities and the roadways and the rivers during the day, but not at night. The terrain itself was enough to defeat any invading army. 30 men well placed in a mountain gorge could hold off a regiment, an army.
We now have over 40,000 men in the service of the United States in Western Virginia. But our large armies are useless here. They cannot catch guerrillas in the mountains any more than a cow can catch fleas. Robert Milroy.
Union General Robert H. Milroy ordered Confederate sympathizers to pay for goods stolen by bushwhackers. If they refused, soldiers were to burn their houses, seize their property, and shoot them. Union soldiers occupied towns, declared martial law, then ransacked stores and houses.
We were engaged all day by the insolent conduct of a company of cavalry who seemed to have taken complete possession of the town. We have no privacy whatever. Our yard and garden are no longer our own, and we are like prisoners. Henrietta Barr.
A company of guerrillas came into our store and took possession in the name of Southern Confederacy and intended to rob the store of everything, and did take about $1,000 worth of goods, Confederate rags. Nancy Hunt.
The Civil War was one of the most divisive and disruptive aspects of the history of West Virginia that one can possibly imagine. A true civil war occurred in the mountains, where one had families and communities divided against each other.
A great share of the calamities of war fall on women. I see women unused to hard labor, gathering corn to keep starvation from the door. Rutherford B. Hayes.
In Philippi, Anna Jarvis, who had lost three of her four children to disease, organized Mother's Day work clubs that provided food and medicine to women impoverished by the war. Joshua Winter's mother and sisters managed the farm on their own.
Dear brother, you don't believe how lonesome we are. I chopped wood yesterday till I had a blister on my hand. Julia is a great big mare, big enough to ride if she was broke. I wish you would come home and break her so I could ride her. Don't forget your loving sister, Annie.
Such a time our new state is having. Lots of rebels trying to destroy it. But never mind. It will shine as bright as any of the 35 after a while. If I were only a man to help fight for it. Cyrene Button.
Both sides recruited women as spies. In Martinsburg, Belle Boyd claimed she obtained information from Union officers in the privacy of her bedroom. The Confederate officer said Boyd could charm the heart out of a monk and cause him to break his vows of celibacy. Boyd was arrested 7 times, each time boasting of her deeds and delighting in the public outrage.
Belle Boyd was taken prisoner and sent off in a carriage with an escort of 50 cavalrymen today. I hope she has succeeded in making herself proficiently notorious now. Lucy Buck.
On the night of May 2nd, 1863, Thomas Jackson was returning to his camp outside Chancellorsville, Virginia, when he was mistaken for a Union soldier and shot by his own men. For a week, Jackson struggled to recover. Then, on May 10th, a warm spring day, Jackson closed his eyes. Let us cross over the river, he said, and rest under the shade of the trees. A few moments later, he died. Southerners were heartbroken. In Richmond, 5,000 people met the train carrying Jackson's body. Thousands more filed past his coffin as it lay in state. In death, Jackson became even more famous. "He was taken away from us," said a soldier, "because we almost made an idol out of him."
So common has death become that when a man dies, he is as soon forgotten. Yesterday I passed by the graveyard of our regiment. Their pure souls shall forever stand unmoved during the wreck of time and crush of worlds. James Hall.
In May of 1864, David Hunter assumed command of Union forces in West Virginia. Hunter ordered his troops to burn the property of Southern sympathizers every time they were fired upon by bushwhackers. Federal soldiers promptly torched the homes of a parson and a widow. Hunter advanced south and occupied Lexington, where he set fire to the Virginia Military Institute. His chief of staff, David Hunter Strother, had a statue of Washington removed from the school and sent to Wheeling as a trophy for the new state. Two weeks later, at White Sulphur Springs, Hunter gave orders to burn down the White, which had been converted into a Confederate hospital. Captain Henry DuPont, a regular guest at the resort, talked him out of it. Hunter moved north to Charlestown, where he set fire to the home of his cousin, Andrew Hunter, the prosecutor of John Brown. When Lincoln received reports of Hunter's actions, he relieved him of his command. On his final day, Hunter had a Union deserter shot. "It is too troublesome to hang men," he said. "We have not time to spare."
What a terrible thing this war is. It has shaken everything to the foundation. One thing is evident. The future will be very different from the past. Martha Watson.
By the end of 1864, the tide had turned against the South. Union forces controlled nearly all of West Virginia. Sherman was sweeping from Atlanta towards the sea. Grant pressing down on Lee in Petersburg. Bushwhackers continued to fight, but it became only a matter of time. On the night of April 8th, 1865, Cavalry Private William L. Wilson of Charlestown bedded down with his company near Appomattox Courthouse, Virginia.
"There is an air of repose and security about camp tonight which I cannot understand. Are we safe at last? My thoughts turn homewards. When will I ever see the blue mountains and green fields of Jefferson again? Private William L. Wilson,
The next day, Lee surrendered to Grant in a farmhouse outside the village.
We marched out within the Yankee lines this morning and stacked our arms. I saw several acquaintances in the Yankee Army, some of my neighbors. James Hall.
They came home. Privates, generals, Union, Confederate. Home to wives and mothers, to neighbors they had met in battle. Home to a state that hadn't existed when they left. Union private Joshua Winters returned to his family's farm and took his sister Annie horseback riding. Anderson Hatfield disbanded the Logan Wildcats and was hailed as a local hero. McNeil's Rangers surrendered everything but their saddles and a few new rifles. One ranger asked if he could keep some gunpowder to go hunting. Anna Jarvis lost three more children to disease and died on the second Sunday in May. Through her daughter's efforts, the day became a national holiday, Mother's Day. David Hunter Strother returned to Berkeley Springs, where he managed his family's hotel and resumed his writing. His war memoir was serialized in Harper's Magazine.
It will one day be considered a great privilege to have lived in these days, to have played a part in the greatest war that has shaken the earth for many a year.
In Washington, Senator Waitman T. Willie personally handled hundreds of claims for compensation from victims of the war and fought off efforts by Richmond politicians to reunite Virginia. John S. Carlisle moved to Maryland, ran for Congress as a Democrat, and lost. Then returned to Clarksburg and ran as a Republican. He lost again and became a farmer. Confederate James Hall, who had been wounded at Gettysburg, began the long journey home from Appomattox.
April 15th. Today we separated. The majority of us will never meet again. April 18th. Slept in a bed last night. The first in many months. April 24th. Came to Philippi and stopped with Aunt Betsy Jarvis. April 28th. Went fishing. James Hall. Thank you.
Major funding for this program was provided by the State of West Virginia, the Appalachian Regional Commission, the Claude Worthington Benedum Foundation, the Clay Foundation, Salem Tekeel University, the West Virginia Humanities Council, and with the major corporate support of Bank One.